Tigret and Bob Keniston and let's see, Phyllis Dock.
B.
B, yes, I'm going down the list here. Raleigh Chapman, Rodney Howe, and Stanley Brown. I think that's all our panelists tonight. Okay, tonight we are honoring the arrival of Frank Edward Hanscom 100 years ago this year at Gould Academy. And I just thought I might give you some of the highlights of his life and hopefully people that don't know anything about him. Oh, Ali, where are you? You're out here. Ali, you're from here.
You can say my name.
Oh, no, I missed you. Okay. I thought I missed somebody. Okay. You can sit right down at the end there. That's right. Try to get everybody up here. And so we're going to try to, I'm going to give some brief highlights of his life, and then we'll go right to the panel and hopefully get as many memories as possible at the time we have tonight. It's important to remember that Frank Edward Hanscom was born in 1863 in a large farm family in West Poland. He lost his mother when he was 17 and was still short of his high school education at that time. He later told the story that he had no confidence about completing his education, but the superintendent of schools, Bert Fernald, who was later governor of Maine, persuaded him to teach us in a small district school, and he said, quote, the first real inspiration that this motherless boy ever had to do something and becoming something in the world. He taught for a while and then went to school and eventually was able to graduate from Hebrew Academy as valedictorian in 1885 at the age of 22. He also was very good at baseball. One of the students he met at Hebron, one class behind him, was Ellery Park, who would be the great Bethel lawyer here for much of the first part of the 20th century. And they remained lifelong friends. He became superintendent of schools and a teacher upon graduation from Hebron Academy. And he was for 5 years at Mechanic Falls and Poland, teaching there. Then he was 6 years as principal of the Oxford High School in Oxford, Maine. Probably through Park's influence, as he later recalled, he came to the academy, which was then a very troubled place. He had 11 years of administrative experience, however, and he was less than 35 years old. He must have sensed some kind of opportunity here, even though things looked relatively bleak at that time. But it seemed that he was very lucky in the sense that things began to happen almost as soon as he arrived. Some of them not good, but some of them very good. So a number of things came to pass after he assumed the position. In 1897, in the fall of 1897, a very fortuitous event occurred when Dr. Gehring assumed the position on the Board of Trustees. Hanscom also immediately saw the Gould needed a lot of community support, so he began to build support for the school in the community by working closely with alumni and the Bethel community. And he almost immediately became involved in the town. He was long president of the library board, he was clerk of the Bethel Village Corporation for 40 years, he was a deacon of the Congregational Church, and he was president of the Bethel National Bank, among other things he did in the community. Mrs. Gehring also began an alliance with Hanscom almost from the beginning of his time at Gould. And she went on and waxed eloquently about what she thought of Hanscom and the opportunities that she provided to Gould. His qualifications were realized, were recognized just a few years after he assumed the position in 1899, when he received an honorary MA, Master of Arts. His man didn't have a college education, remember. He received an honorary MA from Bates College in 1899. In 1931, he was honored with an honorary doctorate in education from Bates. He also received an honorary MA from Bowdoin in 1907. So various academic institutions did recognize his academic qualifications in one way or another. That first year was not an easy year for Hanscom. There was a fire that caused the school to be carried on in two rooms, which were vacant in the Bethel Grammar School nearby. But there was, almost from the beginning, was a perception that after all the turnover, remember Gould had a number of headmasters, something, I don't know how many they were, but there was an enormous number. Almost every year, or sometimes twice a year, there was a new headmaster, new principal, as he was called at that time. And so Hanscom's arrival would be a fortuitous event because he would serve for 39 years, so give the school a tremendous amount of stability. Hanscom had to build an enrollment, however, because the enrollment was down below 100. And remember, in those days, after paying all expenses, what was left was the headmaster's or principal's salary. So that was a very tough thing. But almost in the 1890s, remember, there was a lot of reform going on in Maine educational policy making. And in that 1895, they began to give an $800 subsidy, state subsidy, which was given by the trustees to Hanscom as part of his salary. Hanscom realized a contented, happy student body was essential to attract other prospective students. He also began a sports program, and he also emphasized public speaking and theatrical opportunities. In 1899, he married Rosella Davis, who was 4 years younger, and they, of course, would have five children, which you see here in this photograph. He instituted almost immediately morning exercises, mottos, and quotations were standard fare with Hanscom. Students were urged to memorize, and in the early days, he encouraged students to learn parliamentary law. Remember, he had to do everything in those days. There was no secretary. He taught seven periods at the beginning. There was no treasurer, no dean to handle discipline problems. He was all of these. So remember that as you think about it. And some of the panel will bring out this as well. Every minute was taken up in his day with all these duties, but he still found time to patrol the streets of Bethel to see if any student was violating the strict rule about evening study. He did occasionally allow a social in the gym. There was no dancing in the early days anyway, however. There were also student programs presented at Odeon Hall, down around the corner here, and these were, of course, were very popular, and also the students began to take walks. That seemed to be a big thing with students in this period, early period, going out to the countryside and seeing various things. So that was seemed to be a popular event. He almost immediately began fundraising for the school. In 1900, there were a number of grads gathered, and they came back and they raised $5,600 for the school. In 1903, the first major benefactor, Liberty Holden. I have some letters from Liberty Holden copied from the collection of, you might want to take a look at later on. Liberty Holden came along, and of course he gave the school its first Holden Hall, a house for Hanscom, who he termed the right man at the right time. This was the beginning of the right things happening for Gould. The Garings became very involved. Elroy Park became superintendent of buildings and grounds. Later on, William Bingham comes to town, and by 1919 had made his first major gift of $10,000. The transformation of the campus began after that. Bingham Gym, Garing Hall, and finally Hanscom, built while he was headmaster. He also would see the construction of Holden and plans for the Farnsworth before his death in April 1940. In 1919, he wrote Mr. Bingham, which I think sort of summarizes his ideas about education in a very couple sentences. If there's one thing more than another which I have wanted wealth, it is that I might open the way for earnest, aspiring boys and girls to acquire an education. Every life so touched touches other lives, and the influence will go on in geometric progression to the end of time. And so that sort of summarizes, I think, in his educational philosophy in a way, and the reason why he carried on as he did this along. So now let's turn to the panel, and the first question we have And these questions are only made to stimulate discussion. I'm sure that we'll have other comments and questions and other things from the audience as well as the panel. I'd like to ask each one of you, what's your exposure, what's your experience, sort of experiences did you have in class or just seeing as administrator? What sort of, Margaret, start with you, Margaret, what was your exposure to Hanscom?
Almost constant. Mr. Hanscom was very fond of playing bridge, playing cards, and he hooked right on to my father, as my mother said, was an excellent card player. For the next 30, 40 years almost, until his death, they played regularly. And my mother and father had a rather extensive social life with them because of the card playing and one thing and another. Then, of course, my brother and sister and I had all were in the academy at the same time. My brother was a senior when my sister was a freshman. My sister was a senior when I was a freshman, so it was a period of some 9 or 10 years that was constant. We all took Latin with him. I took Latin with him my sophomore, junior years. He was an excellent teacher, excellent. I went through 4 years of college, 3 years of graduate school, plus, and I never had a better teacher as teacher. But he was a very old-fashioned teacher. Going through Caesar and Cicero, we never had any of these little interesting sidelights about the views of Caesar and Cicero. We stuck strictly to the book. We went right through it with routine. And I give you an example of how thorough he was. In Latin, there's about 15 to 20 prepositions that take the accusative case. There's about 15 to 20, 25 that take the dative case. With Mr. Hanscom, you learned every one of them, and you recited them every day, right straight through. And of course, all of us will go to our graves knowing that. And when Mary and I were in college, and Mary later went on and took her doctorate in Latin and classics at Cornell, and they said they had never in their entire career at Cornell University, which is a huge university, encountered anyone with a better grounding. And I was very well grounded in it too. Nevertheless, it was interesting. You knew it so well. And Mr. Hanscom kept you right to it. There was never any problem of, bright students didn't get bored because dull students were holding you up. He made the dull ones come on, and the dull ones might be perspiration standing out on their forehead, but they had to do it. Now this could be torture if you were too bad, but if you were able to do it, you knew. So that when you were through with Julius Caesar, the only time he ever really got off the text for slightly was he was fond of the passage in which Caesar described how to build a bridge. It's a famous soul breaker. And Mr. Hanscom would stop and go into the nuances of how this particular bit of nasty grammar was interesting. You've had some feeling for the sort of person that Caesar was. At the end of the year, Caesar, like Mr. Hanscom, was very interested in practical things. Cicero, who was a politician, he didn't care so much about. But anyway, you knew him just as well. So he was an excellent teacher. In the community and in the church, he may have started being interested as a matter of policy, but he was very much interested. He genuinely knew everything and everybody, as did everybody at that time. And so you know about socially, I say my mother used to laugh. She was very fond of Mrs. Hanscom, and Mrs. Hanscom was a much easier going, rather passive person. People were very formal and conventional in those days. It was a different period. In 40 years, they always spoke as Mrs. Tibbetts, Mrs. Hanscom, Dr. Tibbetts, Mr. Hanscom. Nobody ever, except Mrs. Hanscom, called him Frank. But Mrs. Hanscom had been the daughter of a very prosperous farmer named Davis. And she told my mother once, sort of whispering, that her father had this unfortunate nickname, she said, that he used to find it very upsetting on Sunday when he came in and the children had screwed the paper around or something. He he'd go around muttering, "Goddamn, goddamn," and so he was known to all the hired men and people in town as old Goddamn Davis. And this had gone on, she said it was very embarrassing when practiced. But anyway, old Goddamn Davis had finally resorted, and Mrs. Hanscom didn't think this was funny, but my mother did, had finally resorted to taking twine and sewing the paper together. Well, you know, Sunday in those days, the kids would get at the comic first, it was a big thing. So, as I say, but old Goddamn, every time my father would pick up the paper, drop it or something, mother would say, "Old Goddamn Davis," you see. But people did. And there was a very good family life. Mr. Hanscom got along very well. The girls used to, Catherine, Margaret, Dorothy used to tease him. The boys were a little bit more formal, and Mrs. Hanscom also told Mother that Edward Hanscom was a slight discipline problem, that Edward had been out milking the cow, and he'd been smoking, which of course was strictly forbidden. And his father had come up, Edward had dropped a cigarette, put his foot on it, you see, hold it. And Mr. Hanscom, of course, could smell the tobacco, and he thought something was going on, but he couldn't quite tell. So he kept hanging around, and Edward couldn't get rid of him at the same time. He couldn't move his foot, and he was really the fuck out of him. Finally, Mr. Hanscom said that, "Edward, I know you've been smoking," and so forth, and that was all. But it was very, very pleasant and very constant. He was a very, he was not without a sense of humor. It was he was very formal, as I say, and he at church, in ladies' club affairs and one thing and another, Mother said there had been at one time the ladies' club had had the man in and been a sort of a tableau vivant to business, and Doris Lord had played the piano, and some pretty girls dressed in gay 90s costume had gone by, and people had been singing, and had come a singing, "Oh, tell me, pretty maiden, are there any more at home like you?" And then there was Mr. Hanscom and G.L. and somebody else who addressed them. And Mr. Hanscom had had handlebar mustaches and pipes and trays, and the mother said he was the hit of the show, leering and twirling his mustaches. That's what she liked. What I remember, to conclude, he was very, very meticulous, never left anything to chance, and all of the social and formal events at the Academy went off beautifully through constant, constant practice. When you had graduation, we had rehearsed for weeks, everybody, the school, not just the graduate. The gowns were a certain length from the floor, you went a certain pace, but when it came off, it went beautifully. Everyone knew his part or her part, everything went along. I think one of the better tales I've ever heard is Erland Runcel's, when he was Mr. Hanscom asked him if he'd do the Gettysburg Address at the Memorial Day services, which is the 30th of May, and Erland was quite surprised about the 3rd or 4th of January, and Mr. Hanscom said, "Now we'll meet and start to rehearse." Well, to cut it all short, they met twice a month from January through to May, and by the second meeting, Ed Erland was had learned the Gettysburg Address. Mr. Hanscom drilled him right straight through. They never missed a rehearsal, but of course, when the Gettysburg Address came off the 30th of May, Erland knew it so well, it was the easiest thing he'd ever done. And I learned, that taught me a great deal, and I must say I learned it in my later career. You can't ever let up. I didn't go around regulating the way in which people walked and that sort of thing. But we were all proud of Gould Academy. We were very proud. Our social affairs, everything like that, always was perfect. And we felt somehow that we were better than other schools. And as the cliche is, we felt good about it. And he made the school, there's no question about it.
Thank you, Mark. That's great. Bob?
I wish I had a memory like that. That's a hard act.
I know it.
I only went to school at Gould 1 year while Frog was still the headmaster. And you mentioned in your introductory that he was seen about town checking to see if people were doing their study and keeping study hours. Well, he had an assistant, too. Percy Crane lived in the headmaster's home. Prof never chose to live there. He kept his own residence up here on Church Street. So Percy Crane, who was the assistant headmaster, lived in the principal's home, or whatever it was to be called. And you could see him once in a while sneaking around Logs Mills, where I lived. And you better have a good excuse if you weren't in the house when he, if you're out in the dooryard, minding your own business, he might not stop for an interview. However, if there were a bunch of you kids playing kick the can or something like that, Mr. Crane thought at this time you got in and went at the books. Now, in Margaret's elaborate discussion on Latin, which I never took, I should have got a grade in Latin because he held his Latin classes in the main room. And especially the freshmen were well exposed. They sat in the front of the room, boys on one side, girls on the other, of course. And Prof had his Latin classes at his desk, which faced the whole room. But you had one ear tuned to his tone of voice, and presumably the other one, you're trying to do your studies for your upcoming class. However, sometimes it was a little difficult to know which one to do. As a disciplinarian, he was well known for a firm hand, and if you were caught chewing gum on the school grounds, that was good enough for a suspension from school. Smoking, you were just gone, that's all. It took me quite a while to learn how to get there, but there was a way to get into the cupola of the academy building, and that was about the safest place to experiment with cigarettes. You were up where the smoke would waft away from you rather than through the halls of the academy building. I guess some of the things I remember was everybody sang a hymn in the morning, the whole student body, and seemed so it was at least 2 out of 3 days that Mr. Hanscom's choice was Abide With Me, and I think probably Phil Dawg can attest to that. She used to play the piano. I always blamed him for the idea of getting up on that lonely stage. Every student had to do this, and give a declamation. Now, that meant that you spent days and weeks going through the library looking for something that you thought that the faculty would approve of for you to memorize and get up there with shaking knees and quivering voice and recite it. And that got to be everybody in school hated, I think, except maybe for a few. They hated declamations. The part of, there was a part of Professor Hanscom, I think he had somewhat of a sense of humor. My first run-in with him as a freshman, and now here I am, somebody from Locks Mills who the furthest they'd ever been to home with maybe a barbershop up in Bethel and back to Locks Mills on the train or something like that. So I was just about as green as grass and lost completely, especially the first semester. So it must have been during the second semester in the lunchroom, which was in the basement. There was a room in there with tables and swing-out seats where the students that commuted would go for their lunch at 12 o'clock. Well, as time went on and we got a little more acquainted, I remember one day I was going from the top of one table through the air to the top of the adjacent table, and the door swung open simultaneously. Professor Hanscom's remark was, Mr. Keniston, if you're in the habit of doing that at home, please continue to do it here. That was his nice way of saying, you're just that close to a home to stay in there. So, I don't know, there's not too many other things that I remember about Mr. Hanscom. I never had him in a class, but I think in those days, most kids were in awe of him and his demeanor, his way of speaking to people and so forth, proper and polite and everything, but best you don't cross him. Other than that, I can't remember too much about Bob.
Thank you, Bob. That's good. Edna?
Well, ask Margaret and Bob, what is that for you? Well,
you could go back and watch it.
I had this hand for my boy. He was my teacher for 1 year. He taught Latin. And I agree with Margaret, the orations of Cicero were firmly established in my mind at the end of the year. I always stood in awe of Mr. Hanscom, but I had the greatest respect for him at the same time, and I think most of the students did. He was a caring man. He cared for all the students, not only as a teacher, but he was concerned about the morals of the students, and quite often, in opening exercises in the morning, we would give a little lecture on politeness and different things that dealt with moral character. I remember there was a bust in the back of the room. Do you remember, Margaret? What was at the bust door? I was trying to think, was it Shakespeare or?
It was some Roman, I thought.
I was trying to think what that was. And one time, just to be funny, one of the boys put a hat on top of the bus. Well, when we gathered for classes in the afternoon, there was dead silence in that room, I can tell you. And we were given a lecture on the respect that we should have for the great men and women that had lived before us, and what a very disrespectful thing that was to do. And I believe the boy, and I can't even remember now who it was that did it, was expelled. And but he did care about students. And I remember one thing that always stands out very, very strong with me was at the end of our year in Latin, Mr. Hanscom, and I wished I could have had him all 4 years like Margaret did, because I loved Latin, but I had a struggle with it the first 2 years, because the teacher, she knew Latin herself, but it was very hard for her to get it across to the class. But with Mr. Hanscom, he made sure you knew and understood what you were doing all the way through. And I think the orations of Cicero would have been very dull if it hadn't been for him. But they really weren't. And at the end of the year, he told us, now he said, just before the end of the year, he said, I'm going to give you a test, and it is going to cover more or less what we have taken up. And he said, I want you to be prepared. Well, I'll tell you, there were just about six of us in the class, and we poured over that Latin one from one end to the other, because not knowing what the questions were going to be. And another thing about Mr. Hanscom, he inspired you to do your best. And so we wanted to be sure. We would get together, we'd study together, we'd pour it over that book. When we met for the last class, he said, now he said, your question, your test consists of one question. know that one question. What would it be? What would it cover? Now, he said, I don't want you to open up your papers up until I want you to turn them over. He had them turned over on our desk. He said, I don't want you to turn them over until I tell you to start. So he said, start. We turned them over. And what was written on the paper was, due to the excellence of your work during the year, you are excused from the final test. And was glad he was an excellent administrator too. And one thing that I always thank him for was the fact we had to learn quotations. In the beginning of the session in the morning at our opening exercise, when the whole school was assembled together, he would call on different ones. We were given periodically a quotation to learn. And then you were called upon. Nobody knew who was going to be called upon, but you better have a quotation ready to get up and recite when he called on you. And those quotations, many of them stayed by me even today. But I remember there was one, good, better, best. Never let it rest until your good is better and your better best. When students were called to give a quotation, they would get up and say that. Well, that was said many times. He had to rule that out. But I was always glad, thankful, that I was able to go to Gould at the time that Mr. Hanscom was the principal.
Thank you, Ed. Thank you. How about you, Phil?
Well, everybody's covered a lot of things I know. However, there are two things that weren't mentioned. And one of his favorite sayings was, a woman's voice is ever soft, low, and gentle, a thing to be desired in women. I've never forgotten that, because I was rather a rowdy. And every morning, of course, they seated in the assembly room before the classes, and Professor Letterman responses from the Bible, readings from the Bible. And I also used to see him walking down Church Street, always formally dressed, never. He was always the perfect gentleman in going into Gould. This always impressed me because the Irish family man only wore suits to church or to club meetings and so forth. And if I happened to meet him on the side of it, we were living in the house where the infirmary is now. And he was always a gentleman, always very gracious, and so I think that too. But he was a strict disciplinarian, there was no question about that. And if you were caught out after hours, I don't know, they were grounded, I think, but I don't know how long. I don't think I can add much to what the others have said at this point. Maybe something will come to me later.
Okay, thank you. B, how about you?
Well, I didn't write down anything. I told Sam that I probably wouldn't have very much to say, but I can tell you, I went to Yarmouth Academy my first year, and I was extremely unhappy. I was with everyone there excepting the two teachers, especially the principal. So when I came to Gould Academy, I had a big surprise. There was all kinds of rules, but if you followed them, you got by beautifully. I and I took all sciences that I could get, because that was the easiest subject for me. But of course I did have to take English and French and history, I guess. Well, anyway, I got along beautifully, and I admired Professor Hanscom so, because I thought he was very, very fair to everybody. But you should follow his rules. And of course my knees shook and everything else when he'd say, give me a quotation. And of course I had to give declamation and be in place and things like that. I remember one time, this doesn't have to do with him, but after all of the other things that I have given, I tried to have something that I thought the student body would enjoy when I stood up there and spieled. But they made me give the Gettysburg
address.
The next day, my English teacher was telling us something. And all of a sudden, he stopped. And he said, Miss Brooks, if you should give the eulogy to my very best friend, I'm sure I'd have to laugh. There wasn't a compliment. Now, my mother went to Gould Academy. She graduated in the class in 1910. She took the teaching course. And that is one thing I was proud of my mother. She was a born teacher. But she went to Gould Academy. And Professor Hanscom was always held up to me as being just wonderful. And she thought Gould Academy was great. And I'll tell you, I thought Gould Academy was great too. When I wanted to go in training for a nurse, I hadn't had Latin. But when they saw Gould Academy written that I had attended, they said, we'll take you. I think you can probably get by without Latin. And I did. Gould Academy has meant so much to me. And when I say Gould Academy, you might as well say Professor Hanscom, because he was Gould Academy. I guess that's about it. I did learn one thing from him, even though I didn't have him as a teacher. My teachers didn't like the courses I'd picked out, and my senior year, they made me choose another one. First, they started in with home economics, or other things, and then home and economics. And I thought I could get out of that by saying that I didn't want a senior go with the freshman. So finally, they said, I'll speak to the teacher and maybe you can take the senior group, go with the senior group if you study hard in the capital. So that's what happened to me. And as a consequence, I had to be a hostess. I had to get the meal menu, see that the other girls did it right, see that they waited on the tables right, like a hostess would have to. And I said, who can I invite? I'm a dorm kid. My mom and father are 60 miles from here. Well, the teacher said, Mr. and Mrs. Hanscom, our professor and Mrs. Hanscom, always likes to come. Would you like to invite them? Yes, I said, I guess I would. They were so wonderful. They made the whole deal so easy. I learned, invite people that are well educated and they'll help you make things easy. And I'm sure I got good rank on that deal because we were being ranked for everything. I was being ranked for everything that happened that day. That's one thing I learned and I've never forgotten it.
Thank you, Pete. Stan Brown.
Yes. Well, I'm afraid that I've probably been a more of an observer than a student. But there are a few things that I'd like to say that they said about the mottos. We had to give mottos. And Norris, can you remember the motto you used to give? Let me ask you for a motto. It's one of the best fullbacks Gould ever had. But Norris would get up and say, if you hit a bit of wax, don't talk to the sun. Is that right? It didn't go too good for Prof. Mr. Hanscom, but I'm not Norris at every time. And just, no, but on my experience with him, I wasn't a student. You say, I not went from that thing. But I had freshman Latin with him when I was a freshman. I'd seen him Latin when I was a freshman. But because he had it in the main room. But it was my best experience with him when I finally made the varsity squad in basketball in the 34 and 5th season. Because Corey jumped in the B squad, and they built the academy at that time, the new academy. So Al Chapman and I, we change up, and the B squad starts for the A squad. We change up, put on our new sweatpants and our new sweat jacket. We go through a new building every night. But we were told that it was off limits, but we thought we had special privileges for some reason. But one night, Mr. Hanscom met us at the door. He said, would you like to see the new building? We said, yes, we would. And let me take you. So he took us all through the new building, everything. He said, you even showed us at the principal office, where we might be called to someday. And after we got through, he took us to the door. And he said, now you've seen it. Now you can leave the people alone. Yeah, that's what we did. But he was very human. And I would say that they said that when my boy went to Gould Academy, was always noted for having good students. And when my boy went to University of Maine, he had a cum dungeon that had been there probably 40 years. He told Corey. He said, he said that back 30, 40 years ago, the students from Gould, we liked them, not come here. They are just as good now as they were then. But he said, the students at Deering, they didn't realize they're caught up, that's all. He says, Gould is still one of the best schools in the state. But he says that Deering and Edward Little have found out that they have to do the same thing, to prepare the kids for college. And he said, you have to prepare just as well as you ever were. But that is about all that I can remember. But I will say that I think that Mr. Hanscom did. He created Gould Academy. And I think if he came back today, that he said good. I mean, he's right now. And that's about it. One more thing. He used to go out to the mail every morning. We got the mail. The post office up in the drugstore is now. He go up Church Street. I hope he stopped and had a cup of coffee at home, but he probably didn't. He probably didn't believe in that. But you go up and get the mail, and in the wintertime, the wind blows on Church Street. He's coming down Church Street, and in the old building, very carefully hanging his coat and his gray hat behind the head up, right behind the desk was the coat room for the principal, I suppose. He'd hang his coat up there, and he put his hat up there. Then he'd stand on the top of the wall, look around, and it was pretty hot. You could see it very, you know, not much air in there. He grabbed that stick and he'd around and adjust all the windows in the school. So cool it off, and he wanted it. Then he'd look, the air conditioner, he'd look around so proud as could be. That's about all. Okay.
Good, thanks. Rosalind.
Well, I had Mr. Hanscom for the
4 years of Latin, well, 3 years of Latin, because his daughters taught freshman Latin. And like Margaret said, he wanted us to be sure that we knew everything. And after we finished a year of Latin comp, and we all passed it, I guess it went before of us in the class, but we all passed it, and we thought, well, that's over. Well, when we came to school the next year, he decided that we hadn't done well enough, we'd all take it over again. So we had an extra year of that, but we did. When he got through with us, we had things that we remember today, certainly. And I haven't heard anything about demerits. The demerit system. That was gone before I got there.
But
it
was nice there.
Yeah, it was there. It was there when my husband was there. And he tells the story that one day the kids at noon were playing Penny and Andy, and Professor Hanscom came along and said, "Boys, what are you doing?" And my husband said, "Well, we're playing Penny Andy. Wouldn't you like to join us?" And he very haughtily turned around and said, "No, I don't believe I will." But he walked off, and it was all right with him. He did, no repercussions or anything. But I do remember that when the kids one night went down to the train to meet kids that were coming back, the dorm kids that were coming back, some of the town students went down, and school was to begin the next day, so townies were supposed to be in at study hours. They weren't supposed to be out, but the town kids were down there to greet the others, and Mr. Hanscom showed up, and most of them were able to get out of the way, but not my husband. And so he was due for demerit, but Mr. Hanscom told him that if he would tell him who the other kids were, that he'd negotiate the demerits. But my husband would not do that, so I guess he never did find out who the other kids were. Also, I remember one thing about Mr. Hanscom. He and his wife always ate down at the dormitory, because their house was up where Dr. Dress's house is. And always we'd see them going down street, always Mr. Hanscom, about 10 feet ahead of Mrs. Hanscom. They never seemed to walk together. Always Mr. Hanscom was way ahead of Mrs. Hanscom. And another thing about his quotations, Phil was telling about this one about the lady, her voice was ever soft and gentle, an excellent thing in woman, but always another one of his things that he dwelled on, when he didn't approve of girls whistling, that was not bad, so he'd always remind us that whistling girls and cackling hens always would come to some bad end. But he had the respect of all the students. I think they were sort of in awe of him, and yet everybody loved him. And I don't know if there's anything else. First there was the dress code, and the girls could not wear socks to school. We all had to wear stockings. That was a no-no. If you got caught without stockings, you had socks on, you had to go home and change.
I think that's about the only one I can think of. Everything else been covered. You know, we all laughed and we got our pencil shaking.
the summary. Every time I think of something, then the next one says it.
But I wasn't there very long when he was, of course. 1 year as principal, and then the second year he was a teacher, and I had him for a CESA, so I know about that. And he, we had it in room 16 for, I suppose that was when he was principal emeritus and so forth. But he really knew it, and I think he knew the book by heart, probably all of them, because one day somebody came to the door, and he went to the door and had talked with him, what he had to say, turned around, started right on going to the lesson. He had no book or anything, it was in the recitation. He just quoted right from the book and kept going. And I think that, as I say, that everybody said that everyone was in awe of him in a way, and yet they liked him, they respected him, and he is Gould Academy.
To go back to the fact that he always had his Latin class in the main room, when the new building was built, it was a Latin room, nice Latin room up on the third floor, And we thought, well, now Mr. Hanscom will finally have his Latin room and they won't have it there anymore. But it didn't make a bit of difference. He'd always had it down there, so he would have it in the new building just the same as he had it in the old building.
I think he liked keeping the study hall, because as he was teaching, he wasn't missing a trick in the remainder of the room.
Right, right. We've done some...
I'd like to say just one more thing I forgot to. My mother told me this, and I thought as if it was true. She said that when Professor Hanscom came to Gould Academy, he said he wanted Gould Academy to be a rich man's school for a poor boy's or poor man's child, and that I wasn't a rich man's daughter. But I felt all the time I went there that I was going to a rich man's school, or a rich school. And I think that describes one of his theories, and one of his desire.
Good. We've done so well covering a lot of these points that we had for questions that we developed. Maybe I can go back to the question of if we could have a few more things that may have irritated him. Margaret, do you remember anything else?
He didn't like sloppiness. He didn't like the most fatal thing in the world would be to try to bluff him. A student never did that twice. And. But any kind of sloppiness, inattention to detail, or neglect of what you were supposed to do, irritated him very much indeed. He could be impatient, and he himself, as I say, in playing bridge, when the Galvan and Matt Fowell were the opposing team, and my father and Mr. Hanscom. Very often they played at our house because my father had to keep office hours. And if someone, a patient came, the doctor got up and left, and Mr. Hanscom had to wait. He would get very impatient indeed. But anything of that sort, he would, I think mainly, as I say, sloppiness and inattention to detail and bluffing, very bad.
Were you there at the time that someone put glue in his seat and he knew what was going on and he worked around the situation and eventually expelled at least one student because of it? And were you there when that happened?
No, I wasn't. I'm not surprised he knew what was going on. After 39 years, of course, he knew every disciplinary trick in the book. And I think he knew every conceivable excuse and every subterfuge. When I was there, there was no dramatic, people weren't doing any dramatic tricks, I guess, or maybe he was. We were there at the very end, of course, and I must say it was a terrible letdown my senior year when Mr. Sales came. And Mr. Hanscom, there was something mysterious about it. He had suddenly retired very quickly, There were no great farewell ceremonies or dinners at the of any sort. He just was retired. I mean, I've seen more spectacular retirements than for one of the custodial staff. But just suddenly he retired, and he had. Then he came back as a principal emeritus to do Latin, and Mr. Sales had come in. Mr. Hanscom's administrative style was very unobtrusive. Most of us didn't know that the school was being run. We did know that Esther Burris was in the front office fielding telephone calls, and Miss Bailey, who taught mathematics, also did all the bookkeeping because he said a mathematics teacher was good at addition. So this was, she did all that. She also kept all the grades and did everything that a computer does now, you know, figured out the but it was all, as I say, no one was conscious of that. And suddenly Mr. Sales was, and the rules and regulations that Mr. Hanscom had, he told us what we were supposed to do, and it was laid down, and it was graven in stone, it was graven in our memories. As B said, if you follow the rules, life is all right. But he never sent out memorandum after memorandum explaining what you had to do. You told him what to do, and you did it. And Mr. Sales was filled with administrative practices and explaining things and asking us how we felt and what did we want to do and let us pleasant consult about these things. And none of it was ever halfway as efficient. And I went to my fourth year of Latin. I was up in that third floor Latin room, which was a dismal little hole. It was very depressing compared to being down in the front room with Mr. Hanscom.
Bob,
you know, yeah, I had a question, Stan.
Yep.
I'd like to know if Bill Clough picked up any ideas tonight.
All right, we used to call and get excuses so that we could go out, like, say, to study with somebody else. I don't know, that hasn't been brought up. But I know that we used to call and find so that we wouldn't get.
Anybody else have anything on what irritated Hanscom?
Well, I might add, I think Margaret covered it pretty well, but he couldn't abide dishonest, no. Cheating of any kind. And he made that very evident to the whole. I mean, he made a classic example of any form of cheating.
I think that, I think that he probably was, I know he was a good teacher. But I think they also, to thine own self be true, on the motto, I know it was over on the school right over the desk.
Right.
And I think that he was as much interested in character as he was in what we knew. I think that he wanted to instill good character in his students. And Raleigh was telling about playing Penny Andy, I know something that caught. And that time you weren't so kind. He says that he says they're down there matching pennies. He says they call it gambling as a boy. And he says that's gonna be over with. And he was, as far as he knew. But he was very interested in that. And he did. I mean, I don't know whether any bad came from matching pennies.
No.
But I don't think it was the best sport for us.
Right.
I can't remember much detail, but something in the back of my head said that Frau Hanscom must have had a hand in doing away with the practice during freshman week or whatever it was. He insisted they do away with the practice of locking somebody in a tomb out at Woodland Cemetery. That seems to be something that sticks in my mind about that. Way back then. Have you ever heard of that, Daryl?
No.
That was every freshman's fear was about getting locked into the tomb out at the cemetery.
Okay, anything else on irritation?
Yeah. Of course, I was a day student, and he used to come back and would be a bunch of boys talking together. And he always come down and he always had some little tricky to us, or words as you get that way. I can remember when I'm good at it. I can't remember well enough to tell it, but always he came down with that little memo for us. We had to stop and listen to him if we're doing.
Good. Moving on to a couple other things. Was there any weaknesses he has in the administrative market? Was he excited with anything?
I think his only weakness was he got old.
Yeah.
The present problems of the state at that time, supervision was minimal. I think it wasn't until we passed the Education Act in the late 1950s that things began to pick up. And Mr. Hanscom would have been very much at sea with that, because as you've gathered from listening to what we've said, even in the 1930s, his manner, this was old-fashioned teaching that he gave us. It was marvelous, but it was an old-fashioned system. And I think he kept things, of course, very close to his vest. If he had dropped dead on the stairway, and he did die very suddenly of angina, of course, a year or so after he left, it would have been assistant headmaster would have had a very tough time indeed finding out what was going on. Probably Miss Bailey knew as much as anyone.
Anyone else have any comments on his weaknesses as an administrator? Or you talked about his strength, but we haven't decided. Okay, let's move out to the audience and see if anybody in the audience has comments or questions from the panel. Does anybody have any questions or comments this time? Yes.
What were the enrollments in those days?
What's that?
Enrollment figures.
Enrollments, I think Gould at the time he took over was about 73 students or something like that, but it did get up to 200 or so.
Well, it was about 200, between 200 and 250 when I graduated. And then, of course, when Ed Vachon was headmaster, it was up to 350.
What time span are you talking about? When did he come?
He came in 1897, and he lasted in 1936 as headmaster, and then he served another year after that, so.
Yeah. I'll say the class of 35, when they were freshmen, was the largest freshman class. At that time, there were 65 in the freshman class. And that largest one was being in the fall of, you probably know. What is that? You know, you were 31, yeah.
31.
There was the largest freshman class they had, was at that time was 65.
So,
and he did, he used to, my father said up until the very early 30s sometime that he ran the academy right out of his own personal checkbook. Before that, what he left over was his, but I don't think it was his that time. I don't think it was left over. But his own personal checks that paid for everything. And Miss Bailey used to be the only one in the office I ever saw, except Mr. Hanscom, right there at the head of the stairs in the old school. Then, of course, Miss Burris was in the new school. But he was the school. And I think that a lot of ways that he teaching in the main room, he taught in the main room back when my father was there. He had his geometry classes in the main room. In all his classes, I think that one thing was to save money, because he could look over the rest of the people in the studying, whereas in his classes there, he didn't have to hire another, he didn't have to have a main room teacher. So, you know, that is that. I think he just got the habit of, that's where he had the classes, so he kept on him the classes.
Okay. Yes.
In answer to Bob Penson's question about, does Bill Pop do anything kind of my wife and I go to our house to the dining hall, she's always 10 feet ahead of me.
That's going to stop tonight. Different story. any other questions or comments from the IS? Paula?
I was just going to ask how many faculty were there when he started and then when he finally retired?
I think we got a picture of him here in 1898. There were five back then, I think. Here, and then probably, how many were there, Margaret, were you?
I guess 20.
20.
Yes.
Okay.
They all had a seat in the front of the assembly hall.
Yeah.
set their face of the students during morning exercise.
A question that, I wonder if anybody recalls, if his freedom to expel students seems to be limitless, boundless. Were there ever any times when parents, as they do now, I spent half my time talking to lawyers, it seems, were there ever any parents that put up a fuss over that or created an issue, or did, when a child was expelled for chewing gum or smoking or whatever it was that it? And no one ever questioned it in town or any of the parents?
Well, I think I'm the oldest one.
1927, is he graduated? Yes.
Has anybody graduated before then? And in my day, the parents were firmly behind the teacher. If you got expelled from school, you better watch out when you got home.
Oh, yeah. Got expelled from school, isn't it?
You had a rough time.
It was a lot worse going home than it was to stay somewhere else.
That's the way it was when I was a kid, too. That's a really significant shift.
The kids said they were lawyers. Other questions or comments from the...
unusual thing, until the beginning of the 30s, I guess, early 30s, the teachers all had to be single. There were no married teachers. I remember that.
No, I didn't recall. Yes, I was done.
With women you're talking about. Women, not men, huh?
Men, too.
Men, too? Okay. These are the women. Only women. So only single...
Margaret, you remember that, don't you?
Yes, I do. I think it was partly to make sure they had teachers not to hold in hall. I mean, single men, male teachers to the... And of course, in the public schools at that during the Depression, many jurisdictions favored, insisted on having single teachers because the, mustn't have two jobs. I mean, nobody had a job, so single women were chosen.
Just bring the dollar sign to light here a minute. I was a resident of Greenwood. And the town agreement paid my tuition for 4 years at Gould. I selected to go for a postgraduate course, so I had to work my tuition that year. And so Ed Hanscom at this time was janitor, Prof's son. He was janitor taking care of the main building. He gave him the job to earn my tuition for the year. He credited my account with $100, which was the year's tuition, and I had to sweep the floor in the main room every night after school before I could go home. That was it for my fifth year.
I thought I was the oldest graduate here, but I see I'm not. But I graduated in 1932, and we had shown me enough file behind me, ahead of me. But we had 150 students, I think, at that time. And I think that the teachers had little rules and regulations about dating and so forth. They had to be pretty straight themselves, as well as Professor Hanscom, very proper.
And at the Friday night dance, you want to be doggone sure you never dance cheek to cheek.
Also, you remember Miss Bailey traveling around the fence with the girls who were down with the flashlight on the way to the movie theater.
Yeah.
Other comments or questions from the audience? Anybody else have any questions or comments? Yes, George?
I haven't heard anyone speak of a Latin grade here. Anyone recall their Latin grades?
Grades? Your Latin grades, Margaret?
Grades?
Yeah, what did you get for grade in Latin? It always...
I was a very good student, so...
Oh, with an A? Yes,
I wouldn't have dared. You see, Mr. Hanscom took his responsibilities as a personal friend of my father very seriously. I was under double pressure. But Stanley, the way he told you, I can remember sitting in the famous room when the class ahead of me had Latin and listening to young Henry Hastings get an absolutely terrible going over Rosalind and Phyllis were in good shape. But anybody that listened to that, what he did to Henry, he was fairly relaxed generally, but not. But you could I could never have had the moral courage not to have been well prepared when I went to class after that, absolutely. But you weren't.
At that time, there were still people coming in, you know, to town to go to school, and the town of Bethel at that time was paying the tuition. And of course, back when Mr. Hanscom was here, the tuition was $100. But by that time, it got up to the state average, which you had to pay the state average. Well, it got so that Mr. Christie didn't feel that we could, we could educate, you know, everybody from between Portland and Berlin, and come over here. So there's one couple. The kids came home, might tell who they are. The kids came to town, so they go to school. The father was living in Gorham, New Hampshire, and mother was living in Portland. They're separated, and the kids came to Bethel.
Yes.
And so Mr. Christie says, well, I'll go up there and see the grandmother. And he said, now, he says, I tell you, he says, if you adopted them, they'd go here. She says, she adopted them. So we paid them. So we paid tuition. But I think that back in those days, they had the deal that $100, but if it went over $100, if it went over 100 students, it was just $10,000, and it never went any more than that.
Mm-hmm.
So it made it pretty cheap.
Yeah.
It made it pretty cheap off high school.
Yes.
The town was sending the kids to it.
Any other comments, questions? Okay, I guess we're all set. Thank you all for participating. Stay right here for a moment.